Well, hello everyone, and glad you found the lecture hall. Kind of made our hike over here. Well, first let me say that it's great to be here. This is my third day in Australia, or second day in Australia, I should say. Last year I won a very nice award and fellowship, national award and fellowship, and part of it was for traveling, and the first thought in my mind is I want to go to Australia. I've admired the architecture and the sensibility that goes on here and the approach to architecture for a long time, and of course developed some very good friendships with Peter Stutchberry, Glenn Murkett, Sean Gotzel, and others that I deeply admire their work and their ethos. So I immediately got in touch with Peter and said, hey, I'm going to be here. Let's make something happen. So it's great to be here. It's the first lecture in Australia. I've got a few others to give in Melbourne. I always start off with this image. I've always done this for the last 15, 20 years. This is my favorite building in the world. It's what we call the Jesus Barn, where I'm from. It's a structure that is at once singular and universal. And it really speaks a lot to our thinking about architecture and how we can be global but act local, how we can develop the connections to place, but at the same time develop a productive tension between it, between the local and the more universal aspects of what we do. Just a brief biographical sketch. Let me see here if I can, this is advanced. How do I make this advance, Nina? Hello? Or not.
Oh, you can just use it.
Or that. Okay. Brief biographical sketch. Here we go. So I was born in Germany. I grew up in a military family. I'm from the south, from Alabama. I grew up loving to draw. In fact, I wanted to become a cartoonist. And I probably would have been, but I read something in the in an article once that said that something like 90% of all cartoonists become alcoholics. And I thought, well, I don't want to be that. So I decided to become an architect instead, only to discover there's lots of alcohol problems with architects, as you probably well know. I've always grown up with a great love of nature. I grew up near the Everglades. In Florida and in the mountains in Colorado for the most part. I had a really healthy love for nature, but also a healthy fear of it as well, which is a good thing, I think, to have play back and forth. My only sport I would ever really excelled at and as a high schooler was in wrestling. I'll tell you a little bit about that later. I wrestled a bear, an interesting story with that. I went to Auburn University without any real knowledge of what an architect is or does, just had heard of Frank Lloyd Wright, loved to draw, needed a profession, came from a very lower middle class family. We didn't have a lot of money. In fact, we didn't have money for college, so I had to put my own way through college, and the way I figured out how to do that was to join a company that basically sells Bibles door to door in the rural South every summer, and I did that for 5 summers, so I became a Bible salesman. And I did really quite well out of it, living all over, like in Virginia, North Carolina, Louisiana, really. And it was great to be in parts of the South that people often only read about, to embed it in the culture, to begin to understand the food, to understand the place, the landscape, develop a deep appreciation for the people of the South, and of course this love in the South of telling stories to illustrate everything. And I did very well, and I got to meet this guy who's at our awards banquet. I was one of the top salesmen, so he was running for president, and a lot of mileage since then, as you can probably tell. I survived 70s fashion. I'm here today. My students call me Dirk Diggler as a kind of aside, but you know, I've always considered myself an independent. At least politically, and so for years, 30 years, I had this one image with a politician and happened to be a Republican. And my chi always felt out of balance because I just had this one politician. So a year ago, I ran into this guy, and I was telling him about my dilemma, and he put his arms around me and said, you know, I think I can help you with that problem. So, and my chi's in balance now. Everything's cool. So, glad to be here. I'm from Arkansas, Fayetteville, Arkansas. This is the northwest part of Arkansas, the Ozarks. We like to call it the land of Bill and a billion chickens. We produce more chickens in Arkansas than any other place in the country. And what I love about the chickens in many ways is the chicken houses. And you see these all over the landscape in northwest Arkansas. And they're almost always oriented east-west. There's long, 30, 40-foot wide buildings, 200 to 600 feet long. And they're almost always oriented east-west. And the reason for that is the chicken farmers figured out pretty quickly, if you could minimize the sun exposure on the east side and the west side and control it on the south, that the chickens wouldn't cook before their time. And I always liked that kind of common sense approach to architecture and to making. And so we try to infuse that in our own work. And so we, in many ways, I live, practice, teach, and build there in northwest Arkansas. And it's very often considered to be in the middle of nowhere, but close to everywhere. We're also the capital of Walmart. You might have heard of that, the largest business in the world, which is nearby. So Walmart allows us access to all the other cities in the country, in the U.S., so we have more direct flights for a small city than any other city in the country. So we have direct flights to New York, Los Angeles, Chicago, Houston, things like that. Princeton Architectural Press did a monograph a few years back on our office, on our work, and they asked for an iconic image of our place. So we've always thought of the Ozarks as that intersection between hills and valleys. In fact, Fayetteville, where I'm from, is or work at, is the only town in the Ozarks where it's built on hills. So you literally can stand in downtown and look out into the agricultural outer limits, let's say, of the city with the chicken houses and cows and so forth. So we found this really great setting in the valley and the hill. And let me see if I can find my laser pointer here. Let's see if that should work. Yeah, so, wow, that suddenly doesn't want to work either. Great. Well, must be the battery. Nonetheless, if you see up on the hill, there's a little silhouette. That's the Old Main, which is the iconic building on our campus. And then this cow with her new cap. And we thought, what a great intersection of education and agriculture, culture and agriculture. And just as we went to take the photo, a Walmart truck drives right through the middle. And of course, I'd forgotten we're also a capital of commerce. So all of that is aspects of our place that we really revel in. It's an environment of real natural beauty where I live, and simultaneously one of real constructed ugliness. And we don't necessarily see that as a negative, but it certainly can be considered aesthetically and culturally impoverished where I work in. We're number 39 out of 50 in almost every socioeconomic category. Thank God for Mississippi. Words like abandonment, exploitation, erasure, nostalgia, they're all aspects of our place. And they're really just as authentic and real as the natural beauty and the local form that exists there. And in particular, I've begun to see this land of disparate conditions as not just a setting for our work, but it really has become part of our work. And so in these conditions, I don't see a negative, but in fact, a deep source of possibilities and direct experience with the world as it's given to us. And, you know, by choosing to stay in what we like to call the Ozark Outback, so a little reference to Australia there, we've begun to turn over the rock and discover the underbelly of our place, so the visceral presences and expressive character that really sustains our efforts there. Now, I'm working from a very simple conviction that architecture is larger than the subject of architecture. So what we try to do is look at the world with a really wide-angle microscopic lens in which we can begin to extract and generate ideas and actions from our concrete experiences of the everyday, between the ordinary and the extraordinary, between one's own personal history and the history of our discipline. And a lot of that has to do with being careful observers. You may recognize the building on the left. I don't know. I know when Peter came to Arkansas, I had to take him to this building. I took Glenn there as well, Sean, taking everybody from Eisenman to Liebskin to Peter Zumthor, Jacques Herzog, Pierre Demure, all taking this little chapel, little glass chapel, which is about an hour from where I live. It's Thorn Crown Chapel by Ife Jones. And this chapel was voted by our AIA, National AIA, as the fourth best building built in the United States in the 20th century. It is truly a beautiful structure made only out of 2x6 wood and glass. That's it. And it is architecture, I think, at the highest order. It doesn't matter what kind of architect we bring to see this. They always react in a really quite visceral way to what's here. Now, just this is in Eureka Springs, Arkansas. So just across town in Eureka is another icon of the land and the place. It's what we affectionately like to call Milk Carton Jesus. He's part of a tourist attraction called the Passion Play, where people come to see the story of Christ acted out by actors, and they've constructed Jerusalem out of 3/4-inch plywood, and you know, looks like Dodge City, so to speak. They had designed this Jesus to be much, much taller than he actually is here. The problem was he was going to be so tall they would have to have a flashing blue light on his head because of the FAA regulations. So they didn't want that, but rather than redesign him or anything, they just cut him off at the knees and shoved him into the ground. And so he's got these proportions of a milk carton. Now, I'm just showing you this to illustrate some of the conditions that we work between, the highs and the lows of culture. But again, we don't see that as a negative. And we don't see it as our task to resolve one condition to another, but in fact to develop resonance between these conditions with the things that we make. And, you know, what this has allowed us to do is to be, like I can say, very observant of the biological, geological, and cultural aspects of our place, which has helped us to form a more bottom-up process that allows us to amplify the small things that manifest the large things. So in the words of our great poet William Carlos Williams, there are no ideas but in things, in the experience of things. And I think in this approach, it allows us as contemporary architects to engage some very critical questions. One is, how do you embrace the world without being consumed by it? And the other is, how do we enrich and dignify the experience of being in the world for those who engage our work? These are ongoing questions that we deal with in just about every project. Now, Leonardo da Vinci had a great quote about working from the experience of things when he said, "It should not be so hard for you to stop sometimes and look into the ashes of a fire or mud or cloud or like places in which you may find really marvelous ideas." So all we're trying to do is, out of the muck of our own condition, is to find really marvelous ideas. And I think what that's allowed us to do is to begin to look at the world in this sort of familiar context that surrounds us and find operations, ways of representing the world in what we like to call a strangely familiar way. And I could kind of sort of illustrate this a little bit to you, this idea of the world of experience and how we engage that. As I said earlier, I was a wrestler. And it was in Colorado, and at the time, I only weighed 102 pounds. I kind of, same height that I am now, so I kind of looked like Barney Fife in tights, and a real skinny guy, and I showed up to practice one wintry kind of raw day in the gym, and we were all standing around, and the coach comes in, and he says, "Hey, listen, fellas, I got a special treat for you today. We're not gonna practice here. I got a van. We're gonna go to downtown Colorado Springs, where I was living at the time, and we're gonna practice there." So we all pile in the van, wondering what the heck's going on, and we drive downtown. And of course, in the U.S., it has, and I don't know if it's this way in Australia or not, but we have these rows of car dealerships. They're all kind of lined up together, and you've got your Cadillac dealership and your Ford dealership. And we pulled into the parking lot of the Buick dealership, and there, in the middle of the lot, was a tent. And on that tent, it said, Bobo the Wrestling Bear. And we were like, whoa. And the coach stops the band, and he turns around and looks at us and said, listen, fellas, you have to be prepared for anything in life. So today, instead of wrestling with each other, we're going to wrestle a bear. And we're like, wow. You know, we're full of testosterone and kind of invincible anyway, so at that age. So I said, sure, sounds like a great idea. We get out, we see some of our parents standing around the tent. And we go into the tent, and the coach stops us, and he says, now, before you go in, you need to know a couple of things about wrestling a bear. He said, first thing you need to know is that a bear is anatomically incorrect for wrestling. It's got a large, bulbous upper body, short, stubby legs, very uncoordinated. All you have to do is go for a two-legged takedown, catch the bear by the heel, pull on it, he'll fall on his butt, roll on his back like a turtle, and you just jump on him and pin him. I thought, oh, okay. So we got a strategy here. So we go into this tent, which isn't much bigger than the space that I'm standing up in right now. And there's a mat, and there's a long bench. And then on the other side of the tent is this humongous bear. I mean, he's like over 6 feet tall, weighs about 600 pounds. He's got a muzzle on. He's got a chain around his ankle tied to a tire axle driven into the asphalt. And then he's got this guy with a striped shirt with a whistle standing next to him, who's the owner. And it wasn't like Discovery Channel or anything like that. I mean, there were like these smells and noises and grunts, and we're like, whoa, this is real. And the coach said, well, listen, we're going to start with the heavyweight, and we're going to work all the way down to the 98-pounder. And of course, I was greatly relieved because I knew it would never get to me. I'm next to last, so no worries. So we all sit on the bench. They unhook the bear. They bring him out onto the mat. Our heavyweight, the stud of the team, gets out onto the mat. He gets in his crouch. He blows the whistle. He goes for the two-legged takedown. And the bear puts him immediately in a bear hug and lifts him straight up into the air, pile drives him head first into the mat, slips a half Nelson on him, flips him over, and pins him just that quick. And we sat there for a moment, and then it dawned on us. The bear knew wrestling moves. And then the carnage really just began, right? So the next guy gets out, goes for the two-legged takedown, bear hug, pile drive, over. And it's like, oh my God. And of course, a bear is not genetically programmed to wrestle, so that he has to have a treat between each match. So their treat was an orange crush, a Fanta, which he could drink, get a little sugar high, and get ready for the next victim. So it keeps working. And finally gets closer to me, and by this time I'm slack-jawed, sitting on the bench looking, and the coach comes over and says, hey, Blackwell, listen, you're not very big. You're not very strong. He's got this nose about this close to mine. He says, but this bear's really tired, and you're really fast. I think you can whoop it. And I was like, yeah, coach, I think I can. Okay, I'll do it. So it's my turn. I hop on the mat. I get in my crouch, you know, like a spider, and they blow the whistle, and I go for the two-legged takedown, and I caught the bear by the heel. I couldn't believe it. Caught this bear by the heel, and I pulled on it, and I pulled again, and nothing happened. It was like pulling on a tree stump. And my father, who was there, said, you know, just for a minute, he said, the two of you were frozen as one. But then the bear relaxed at 600 pounds on top of me. There was just a pair of Adidas tennis shoes sticking out from him. He grinded his abdomen in my back. He slips a half Nelson over. He flips me over to a very awkward position to where his nose and my nose are touching. And just as they blow the whistle to pin me, he regurgitates all of these orange crushes. So, I mean, complete disaster. I hop up. I mean, my tights are torn. I'm totally humiliated. And I've been slimed by a bear. And I go and sit on the bench. And, of course, the first thought coming to my mind was, geez, that could have been a lot worse. And the irony of the story is the next wrestler, his name is Mike Griswold. You can actually look him up on Google. He was the state champion that year, Colorado. Got out on the mat, got in his crouch, they blew the whistle, zoomed in on the bear, caught him by the heel, bear lost his balance, fell on his back, Mike jumped on him and pinned him. And that's my story. Now, as an architect for the last 40 years, I've thought over and over about, man, what does this mean? I mean, how can I use this in some kind of useful way in my own work? And I finally came to the conclusion that, in fact, it doesn't really mean anything. The reality is just no particular message. I mean, the effect it has on people that I tell it to or on myself endures not because of a particular message, but because of its material tangibility, right? It's not about an idea or the experience of an idea. It's experience itself. And that, I believe, is a possible domain in which you can work in architecture. And that is exactly what we're trying to do. Now, I think in many ways it's safe to say that most architecture isn't very good. And most good architecture is good enough for most days. But there are some buildings, some architecture, that need to rise above the everyday. And I think this necessarily challenges us to return to the significance of the everyday and enrich it and revalidate it through the things that we make. So in many ways, we are working between the motivating forces of the everyday, where the inadvertent meets the purposeful. In fact, my wife is my partner. She's on her way here right now. We were talking the other day, and we really came to the conclusion that our task is really the task of recreating strangeness, to intensify our experience with form and place. And we're constantly looking at relationships between things that are more nature-made and things that are more man-made, finding ways for those things to come together to help us rethink about how we occupy space in some way. So this is a series of prototypes that I've done, one of them being the Dragonfly House, where we took a dragonfly and a camper and kind of, you know, did some architectural husbandry, brought those together, and then this prototype that can sit in the wetlands or in the desert, creates its own shade, and it's very kind of light upon the earth. So, and we have a whole series of these that we work with. But we're often thinking about how we can work with typologies, how we can make typologies and understand them as something more evolutionary and adaptive, more dynamic rather than fixed, which comes much more about style, and really begin to think of how those can be useful to us in a more hybrid sort of way. So over the last 20 years, we've developed a whole body of work. So this is like a family tree of the work where we began to see the precedents, the things that like the villas and the shotgun houses and the vernacular, and see how that begins to inform our work through these relationships between more, again, nature-made and culture-made conditions, and then how that evolves ideas one into another to create a whole body of work that we're still trying to understand ourselves. But as a former cartoonist, most everything that I do is developed in section and in profile as I try to kind of situate that. So that's been a kind of real driver, and it really becomes the project outside of the projects in our office, the project we're often working on, beginning to think about how to make the most expressive figures in a landscape of barns, and chicken houses, and silos that have a kind of singular effect that they can begin to take hold of places where there's more space than form. And always thinking about working between, how we work between the more idealized in our discipline and the more improvised. And that's allowed us to kind of come at it in a lot of different ways. This is a small structure in North Carolina for a beekeeper. It's a honey house that we did that pretty much is all prefabricated in Fayetteville and then shipped to North Carolina to be constructed in about 3 weeks. And it's just a very 8 foot by 24 foot long structure with an outdoor work area. And it's one single element is a load-bearing steel plate and glass wall that supports the structure and then begins to act as the storage and display for honey, which really came about from looking at that relationship between the beekeeper and the bee that's evolved over thousands of years. This is a diagram of a bee box. In the bottom is the brood chamber where the queen lays her eggs. And the top are more of the places where the food is stored, the honey. And, of course, you smoke the bees, neutralize them, lift the top, and pull the honey without disturbing the queen, which would she takes off, then everything collapses. It's a great sort of process. And so we love these Cartesian frames, but, again, the bee is genetically programmed to behave how it must. So there's really two systems at work here that acted as the inspiration for the steel plate and faceted glass wall. This creates the deep space, acts as a brise-soleil on the south, but also actively organizes and displays the honey. This is a $40,000 project that we did. Another project is a seven-story house in Fayetteville. Really thinking about what it is to look at the vernacular locally, but also, you know, through my own travels in Italy and in Yemen, beginning to leverage some of that in our kind of thinking of what a tower house could be. Originally, it was supposed to be a tree house, but there are trees, you can see, they don't grow very big where I'm at because our cash crop is rocks. And so we don't have a big agricultural base, and our oaks can't support an actual house in the tree, so we made a tower house instead. But we were very interested in how that structure met the ground and met the sky. And so at the ground, the immediate aspects of nature, patterns and textures were examined, and we were quite taken by the striated bark of the trees, especially the hickories and the oaks. And so we milled some of those about 20 miles away into this white oak lattice sunscreen fin around the base that goes up as high as the mature height of the trees. And then we skinned it with a beautiful white metal skin, because we wanted to take part of another order in the landscape, which is all these infrastructural, industrial, and agricultural buildings that are pop up above the canopies in the place that I live. So really thinking about the immediate or the near and the more immense aspects of the landscape and how to communicate with that. And then up top, having a 360-degree view of the landscape beyond. This is a kind of a Mesian space where your height of your eye to the floor and your eye to the ceiling are equal. So you can flip the space upside down and practically have the same spatial experience. So it creates an intensification of the horizon. A stair falls out of the ceiling, and you go up into what we like to call the sky court with controlled views to the landscape and then open to the sky. A great place to kind of experience the cosmos and sleep out under the stars. Again, kind of rethinking typological precedents, we were asked to do and design a contemporary golf clubhouse in Fayetteville, Arkansas. This is one of the first contemporary clubhouses in the U.S. in about the last 30 years. The owner, who's the CEO of Tyson Foods, said, you know, I don't want another plantation home or a hunting lodge like you normally see in the U.S. He says, I'm looking for something that of its time, but connected to its place. So we use locally quarried stone and copper, timeless materials, then and a very simple footprint, a very concise footprint for this particular clubhouse, and then created surprises on the inside that you wouldn't normally find. Beautiful wet areas, a Roman bath with the skylight from above. Somebody on a blog for Art Daily saw this when it was published and said, gee, Peter Zumthor called and wants his baths back. And I really loved the next comment was like, yeah, and the Romans called Peter, but they'd like theirs back as well. So it's kind of fun to, you know, be part of a kind of lineage, always looking backwards as a way to kind of look forward as well. And, you know, when we were approached to do this, I'm not a golfer, and I'm immediately made the owner aware of this. I mean, I don't know anything about golf. I don't know how to do a clubhouse. And he shot back and said, hey, man, this isn't about golf. He said, this is about people and space. I was like, well, I can do that. And so, you know, sometimes you listen to your owners, right, because they can educate you. How to respond to disasters typologically. This is a challenge we were given post-Katrina in Biloxi, Mississippi, which was the only town in Mississippi that rejected the new urbanist approach to redoing the coast. They decided that not everybody wants to live in grandma's house with a geranium on the porch, that in fact we could develop prototypes that would seriously take on the new FEMA regulations that demanded all new buildings in the city limits to be elevated 6 to 11 feet above the street level, which has a lot of implications to the urban fabric and social fabric in many ways of the city. So we were asked to start with a shotgun house, which is a typological vernacular there. So this shows the evolution of that. We raised it up, but we knew that this great sort of interface between the private world of the house and the public world of the street was the porch. And so we kept the porch on the ground. We had stacked the program to create a more concise footprint, just enough to get cars and storage underneath. And that evolved into what we like to call the porch dog house. This had to be a market rate house that could be repeated. So it's got a sort of some partial steel and wood with the porch, and then wrapped all in metal siding. And with just simple strategies like perforating the stair so as the water rises, it can push right on through rather than pushing in or pushing up and destroying the underside of the building. And just simple, just allow the owners to kind of decorate it as they will. This is, the owner is Richard Tyler. He's a single father of three kids who chose the design, and we built it on his property in place of the house that had been destroyed. Very simple strategies of controlling the sun with the sliding panels on the east and west side. Some roll down, some slide over. But these also can be locked. So it becomes a safe box when a storm comes, a Category 4 storm, where folks can leave. So many folks in New Orleans and in the Gulf Coast died because they were afraid to leave because of just their possessions and the looting that often occurs after these sorts of events. In this case, one can lock everything down and leave and feel pretty safe. And I just want to say, this is, I don't know how it translates in Australia, but this was done for $135 a square foot, so which is a market rate house that can be repeated. Very different from the make it right houses that Brad Pitt is doing. So, but I have to be careful because you can get booed for criticizing Brad Pitt. So. So this idea of the porch, this idea of what you call the veranda here, it really become a driver because of where I'm at in the South. And we're currently working with James Corner's office, landscape architect that did the High Line in New York. We're working on a 4,500-acre urban park in Memphis, Tennessee. And part of that is to expand a lake, a 50-acre lake, to an 80-acre lake, and locate seven structures around the edge of the lake: a visitor center, a restaurant retreat center, boat kiosk, stage pavilion, picnic pavilions, and create an ensemble of work. And so the way in which we approach this is to go back to origins here, these simple sharecropper houses or big sheds that you find in the rural South in this old farm, and begin to think how we could convert that into a language for this building, not only in terms of form, in terms of performance, but also in terms of even material, the types of materials. And the context here is, you know, just lovely with the lake, and this is what you see, the existing visitor center, which we immediately convinced them to tear down, which is pretty awful stuff, that we didn't really feel was representative of their brand. You can see the lake currently under construction as they expand that, and again, I don't have the laser pointer, but the structures are being located around it. So the first project is the visitor center, which faces southwest. And so we came up with sort of a dog trot, a series of pods that has it's 8,000 square foot visitor center with an 8,000 square foot porch. So this is all done with trusses and extends beyond, and we calculated all the sun angles so that at no time of the year, winter or summer, does this not get shade. And so they really can begin to program the outside of the building as much as the inside. It's currently under construction, as you can see. And it's all out of bar grate and trusses, real tough agricultural type material. And then we're lighting it, working with a lighting designer, Richard Renfro. So this thing comes to like a jellyfish at night as it lights up internally. And underneath, you know, in Memphis, you can be in the shade and still sweat like a pig. So the key is to ventilate that shade to get the airflow going, just like you would be in the forest in the canopy. And so we have 5 20-foot big-ass fans, that's what they're called, that ventilate the shade there. And we can reverse that as well and push air down. A stage pavilion here on the edge of the lake for performances on the lake, and then also for a small 3,000 kind of amphitheater, boat kiosk, all out of the bar grate. All the boats are stored in this metal box with a concession stand. picnic pavilions, we like to call the crickets, that kind of are dotted around the edge. And then a restaurant retreat center of local stone and zinc-like, I guess it's called, you call it zinc alum, along with the bar grate, and surrounded by a farm, where they have farm-to-table vegetables that are grown. But the key to this, it's a multi-purpose event center, is a huge porch that this is facing west, so it takes care of the low western sun, provides sunsets, and then people can set out and eat and dine without being blinded. So all of this is currently under construction, but it forms a whole language now, an ensemble, just using this one interface, the porch. And just carrying that further, this is a Montessori school we just finished in a floodplain. It's an extension of a campus here that done for under $200 a square foot. This is for grades 1 through 4. The owner only had 7 students. Her facilities were really terrible, so she thought things would get better. She built a new facility. So this is facing south, place to drop off, place to arrive at in the entry porch. We're in a floodway and a flood zone, so they only created a triangular area where we could build, and then we sort of extended out into that floodplain with one column, is what the Corps of Engineers would allow us. So we resolved, you know, what to do with a triangular site. Not a lot of good triangular buildings in the canon of architecture, so we resolved it with 2 boxes, let them overlap. Creates a rain garden in between the courtyard to mitigate water. It's got a green roof. Simple hard materials, concrete, steel stairs on the inside. It's all outfitted with fauna and nature objects of nature that the owner has it done with. You rub a buffalo hide on the way up, that kind of thing. Then the green roof up top. Very simple, nice well-lit classrooms. Everything that they didn't have before. Biggest triumph, though, for us as a design team was trying to resolve just transitions in the building. And in particular, this corner that went from 60 degrees to 90 degrees. And we're using a box rib metal system, which is off the shelf, but we custom fabricate the corners and the trim parts of it to give it a really nice abstract look. So we, working in BIM, which we do with Revit, we modeled everything to help make that transition, which was the strangest piece of trim at the corner we'd ever seen. But we knew that visually it would work. And then we had the contractor rebuild it 3 times to get it right. He asked us to lose his phone number afterwards. But nonetheless, we got this transition. And you know, this was a small victory. But we, a kind of small building like this, you look for these victories. And this is where you go have a bourbon afterwards and feel like you've put in a good day's work. I just want to say that currently she has 120 students. She's maxed out. And now we're building her primary school across the creek and a bridge to connect to that. So it's good things that, you know, what architecture can do. This idea of the idea of extension of the building to develop spaces between really came about from this project that we did for an art nature park for the Indianapolis Museum of Art. A visitor center located in the park, really tough place. It's located in an oxbow of the White River that runs through the middle of Indianapolis, and the canal on the other side. It's an area that used to be forest, and then it became pasture. And then, as you can see in the top image up here, they dug it out for a quarry to make for limestone to make the interstate through the middle of the city, and then it filled up with water, and it's now become an amenity in the city. So what makes this place really kind of wonderfully weird to work on is that they've had 3 100-year floods in the last 6-7 years because of indiscriminate development upstream. And so the river, which you can see in beyond, actually rises above the lake and breaches into the lake, creates all these type of wetlands, scours the landscape, very volatile landscape. And so how to build between land and water and a volatility here. And of course, we had started with 100 acres. Once we took the lake out, we only had about 60 acres. And once we factored in all the floodways, the flood zones, and easements and all that, we discovered we only had 0.67 acres to build on. So it's very easy to find the site. And ours is kind of located in the woodlands up above here as an extension of a series of pathway journeys, working with landscape architect Ed Blake and environmental artist Mary Miss. We were able to create a sort of narrative through these different landscapes that, you know, talk about the ecotones and how they things intersect in this land. And then the art, as you can see on the far left, this type of site-specific art and plazas, recycled material of limestone and wood that was found, bridges through this, through the woods, towpath along the canal. And then our site, which is very wet and fecund in the woodlands, no particular view. That's it underwater. And so the challenge was us is how to build this by pulling it 5 feet out of the forest floor, right at eye level, which was what we were instructed to do. So I'd begun to make some sketches, and I'd begun to show those to my landscape architect, Ed Blake. And he came up with a really, I think, brilliant idea, which was to, since we had these ramps that were extensions of the pathway journey, said, why don't we allow those to sit astride a figured mound, like a small Indian mound that you might find. It's about 3.5 feet that would just, like a berm, rise up out of the out of the forest floor, and then this thing just sits astride, floats just above it. And it was a really brilliant way to kind of gradually let this thing come on up. And then those figures, those points, point to particular views that he had created through the trees. So here's, you see this very quiet building that you only discover as you get closer to it. And we really looking for things that we had found on the site, just as a source of inspiration, the butterfly wings that we, you know, got a microscope and looked at, and looked at leaves eaten away by insects, where the structure is left, but there's a porosity in the surface, and reminded me of the canopy of the trees, of how light and water comes through, and could we make a structure that allows light and water to come through it, that is porous in itself, but really, really strong. And so, just to illustrate this, we thought, okay, one material, one primary detail, a floor, a wall, and a canopy, all of the same structure and material. And so I wanted to illustrate this through an animation that we do. I know you guys are really into animations, right? Y'all do animations? No? They don't do that here? Okay. So this is how we do animations in our office to illustrate the idea. Pay attention. Okay, thanks. In case you missed it. One surface, fold it over like a big taco, and then the programs in between, a lounge, bathrooms, a kitchen, all that service for the park. And then the structure itself, all out of 2x Ipe that's on edge, attached to an exoskeleton, steel, working with a really great structural engineer, Dean Nordenson. And the beauty of the structure is that it's quite dynamic and heavy, but you don't see it really, because you just see the shadow of it as it's imprinted on the porous surface. And this is a very dynamic surface because that shadow is constantly moving as the sun moves throughout the day and the seasons. And then these oculi, we pleat the system. So rather than punching through it to create oculi where, you know, begins to figure the snow and figure the rain as it comes through and the light. And to get it past the codes, we had to deal with the deck. So we filled the voids with 1x2 acrylic bars, UV rated, so that you could at least walk on it and still light and water would come through, and then you can light it up at night. It gets this kind of ghostly appearance, this apparition in the woods that we're sort of after. And then everything sort of comes together and it's carefully cohered. The glass vitrine, which is the lounge, and then the black box of charred cedar, which is all the service components for the park. And then inside, water popped, ebonized white oak. So it's really polished, much like the museum. It's come down to the woods. And then this variety of lighting that's very similar to the outside. This is situated into the landscape. Just with the only, everything turns silver, all the wood does, except for the black box as it sits in the landscape. And then it's something that really starts to have its own character no matter what the seasons are. And then the killer shot. Gotta have the killer shot. So this was the first national award winner for the city of Indianapolis ever from the AI. It's something that's really become a small but beloved structure in the city. So this idea of taking a simple unit, a simple piece of wood, and repeating it multiple times, a lot of it comes from looking at Faye Jones and looking at something like Thorn Crown, really informed us on the new museum store for a Moshe Safdie designed American Art Museum in Bentonville, Arkansas. And we were asked to do the retail store as something that would be an extension of the museum experience. And when we won the competition, the construction for the museum was already underway. We really didn't even know what it looked like. So we just sort of had to guess from some drawings and materials they were using. This is the museum today. It sits astride a creek near the downtown Bentonville. It's all concrete, wood, copper ceilings, and Softy's characteristic bombastic forms and things. So what to do? In the orange crescent is this sort of strange shape was the white box for our store around a plaza. Very strange kind of notion about retail there. And what we were given is the only room in the entire complex that wasn't architectural concrete, and it had columns every 10 feet to hold up a green roof up above. So it was a really tough space. But what we were more focused on was the material culture, how we might could take sourcing our local hardwood forest in some ways, and then finding a unit that could be repeated, that could build up a kind of energy in the place, and it could be somewhat powerful in it, and a reshaping of that space. So we developed a carapace, a hanging carapace that wraps the wall and wraps the ceiling that's a kind of contoured and recreates a sectional identity for the store itself, all made from locally sourced cherry plywood, and then all the furniture made from, and the display units made from local sourced walnut. And this entire store was fabricated with the three-axis CNC. So every rib that you see, there are 286 ribs, is custom and different from each other. And we optimized that on about 480 sheets of plywood to minimize waste, and then created this cloud, so to speak, that wraps. You can embed merchandise in it. A lot of this came from looking at some of the local artists that were going to be featured in the store, one being Leon Niehaus, a great nationally known basket maker from Huntsville, Arkansas. We went to his studio, and we noticed that he drew everything on newsprint paper with charcoal in profile, and then he would extrude that profile along a path, and then as he closed in on itself, it created flourishes and things that gave it a very specific expressive character. And so this operation of the profile and path really informed some of the early sketches. We're trying to develop a section that would kind of take the western sun that you see on the left and take 40% of that out, at least baffle it through the space, and then hide all the sprinkler systems and ductwork and stuff, and then we can bury merchandise and storage in this as well, and it really creates a new environment for the space. And those then evolved into these 8-inch ribs with their own connections that could be hung, and there's two or three pieces to each rib, and that's all fabricated on the CNC, and then that evolves into the space. And that's Adam from UDI. This is a guy who makes newel posts for stairs and just basic millwork. It's a new challenge for him to kind of develop this whole system, connections, everything, all on this one three-axis CNC. And this is the array, every single one. That's everyone different. We had to do the customization because the lines run parallel to the curve, not to the radii. It was very important for us to do this as for costs. We found out that if we did this by digital fabrication, we could save 40% on the cost of the store, which is important. Who are we working for? We're working for Alice Walton, second richest woman in the world. Well, we had to work to a budget, you know, and that's the way it works where I'm at. No crazy money in Northwest Arkansas. So here they are installing it, one piece at a time, just like the guy said, you know, it's like sort of hanging stone in the air, stacking stone. They too asked us to lose their phone number after they were done. I was telling Peter the other day, or this morning, I think, at breakfast, said, you know, if you want to be a good architect, you really got to be good at post-rationalization. And you agree, right? So one of the guys in the office was looking at this and said, wow, you know, what we're doing looks like a lamella, like the underside of a mushroom. So, yeah, that's a great idea. So anyways, we went with that, made some diagrams. This is good stuff for students to know here. You can really baffle your professors. And so rather than the radii, that how nature works from the stem, we show the parallel lines and why those ribs have to be different. But it gives order to the space between the ribs, which is what we needed. And so you can see the light being baffled through and the whole layered system, and then how that all comes together. And then all the vitrines, the cache wrap that begins to be quite an organic shape, display, really a science to how things are merchandised. We learned a lot about that. We're now doing another one for the Shelby Farms, the park, urban park I showed you earlier. Now, what Ms. Walton loved about this was this store paid for itself in 4 months for its profits. And so we were able to demonstrate to her that good design can be good business. And as a result, she's given us more business. So that's all good. Now, taking this line of thinking, we thought, well, how can we push this further? How do we take it a little bit further? So we were approached by the Smithsonian Institute, the Renwick Gallery, which is the decorative arts component of the Smithsonian, to reimagine their grand salon. It was an invited competition, and we're really excited about this opportunity to take a great space and turn it into an architectural destination that could be used for a variety of events, banquets, movies, speakers, any of that sort of thing. So this is the Renwick Museum, which is the closest Smithsonian structure to the White House in D.C., the Grand Salon with its art, which would come down. We could do anything we wanted in the space as long as we didn't violate the structure of the space. And this would be an installation for 5 years and then would be repurposed in some way. And we expected to go in and find, you know, Tiffany glass and things like that in the decorative arts. But what we found is already artists tapping into new technologies and materials, how to use those. And we were really blown away about the modernity of it all. It wasn't sort of this antiquated collection. And so with that line of thinking, we again returned to origins, thinking about D.C. and what it once was primarily a swamp. And we thought, what would happen if you came into a space and we literally could bring the forest into the city and kind of reimagine its origins and what that might be like. And so we knew there was a remnant swamp left over about 100 miles away called the Pocomoke Swamp in Delaware. And we thought, well, what if we could harvest some of these cypress logs, which they allow, the small ones, they allow a little bit each year. And if we could do that pretty economically, then we could bring this kind of veneer, which is what we want to do, to reskin like a whole new epidermis for the room. And so we developed a series of lanterns over 400 and something lanterns, 2 feet by 6 feet tall, that acted as like lighting bells and the canopy of this room. And we calculated all the logs that we needed, which was 10 logs to make the vertical surface and the canopy above. And then planks for the floor and up the end wall. So you're totally wrapped in this cypress and this wood that was originally part of the DC. And we looked at mock-ups and other things we could do to begin to think about it. And then it's lit between, so it's so thin that it's quite luminous. And so these are the a variety of lanterns and the ones we settled on. And then we proposed arraying them in the ceiling of the room. And looking at the proportions, about how that would work, even the proportions, the classical proportions, kind of mirroring that with the room as it existed. So this is the room as it exists today, and this is that space. And you notice it's quite stable, and lots of deep surface in the space and how it might act as an art gallery. But there are no people in there. So as soon as got an appointment? No, okay. So, but when people come in, this is what happens. So each of the bells is actually on an actuator with a motion sensor that begins to respond to people. It becomes interactive. So this is a space we imagine that had the capacity for change, that was imbued perhaps with the order of change, and actually could be programmed manually for specific types of events that would help acoustically or atmospherically. And all of this is powered by a solar array on the existing building. Then we kind of developed the range in which these bells could move, each one having its own different range, so they could create its own kind of topography or configuration. And so for speaking, events might be ordered one way. Again, light, we had a lighting strategy for how to create this luminous condition without ever seeing light itself. And then movie night, kind of configuring that correctly for acoustics, working with acoustic engineer as well. Banquet night. Fashion. And then working out all the systems of how you know, you're changing the airflow, how that would work differently, and how we could recirculate air behind the skin and through the skin. The structure, that it doesn't allow any penetrations into the existing envelope or of the room, which is all aluminum. It's a beautiful structure by Dean Nordenson. And then we attach all our skin to that. So, and then it's just sort of inserted, built as a Trojan horse, and then can be disassembled. And then we have our own MakerBot in the office, so we're constantly 3D printing and looking at a variety of configurations that we could develop with this. To illustrate to the client how this can change, and then going from there to building section models again, so and then lighting those so we could kind of illustrate the possibilities. We were quite excited, and we presented live in DC to the Smithsonian, and we presented this image amongst others, and it was we thought it was going well, and somebody stood up and said, we don't do weddings. And then the presentation started to go in another direction, and then we told them the cost, and which wasn't too bad. I think it was under $2 million for 5 years, and they could repurpose all of the wood and stuff. Needless to say, we didn't win. They picked a firm that their strategy was to shoot images on the wall and the floor to make it look like clouds and stuff. So they really weren't interested in architecture. Not, but I mean, the way we looked at this is we had a great exploration using ideas, and ideas that could be an investment in our spiritual savings bank that we could draw upon at a later time. But anyways, we learned a lot. We don't do that many competition. I know it's a bigger thing here, but it was a great way for us to expand as an office. Now, I want to finish with three quick projects that I think are very important, perhaps some of our most important projects. But they're dealing with issues around sustainability that are more about repurposing, which I think is the thing that we can do best. We're walking through the city this morning looking at older buildings. We're looking at the newer ones and how they, in many ways, don't measure up, and the older ones who are looking for new meaning, new purpose. And the story here is that you see here is a fellow who worked for William J. Fulbright's mill. If you've heard of the Fulbright scholarships, William J. Fulbright was from Fayetteville, Arkansas. And his family owned a mill, and they made farm implements, plowshares, axe handles, and wagon wheels, and things like that. And post-war, there wasn't a lot of use for that. There's another person from Fayetteville who was building an arts complex, the first on the University of Arkansas campus, the first in the United States, a fine arts complex of all the arts together. His name was Edward Durrell Stone. And they were friends, and they were talking about this, and Mr. Stone had an idea. He said, what if we turn these implements that you're making into a line of international furniture that we could market? I could outfit it in the building, and then we could market it and give a new purpose. And that's exactly what they do. These are images from the Getty file. So these plow handles become chairs. The wagon wheels become these beautiful benches. And we use the craft of the Ozarks, the basket making, for the strips of white oak to develop the rattan chair. Very important. And so this really gives whole new purpose to this material. So in a similar way, we can do that with buildings. I start in a small town in Gentry, Arkansas. that is on Main Street. It's a library. Well, let me tell you a little about the town. The town is a very poor town, 2,500 people. The only company they have there in the town is a Little Debbie snack food company. Probably don't know what that is, but oatmeal cakes, things like that. And they have a wildlife safari zoo. And you drive through the landscape and monkeys jump on your car and emus chase your car and things like that. So kind of crazy place. But it's a very poor town. In fact, their public library was privately funded. But they had a dream of having a real library and a real community building. And so they approached us about taking an old hardware store that they had been given and transforming that into a library, a public library. And this is what we were given, and a building with all the glass blown out of it mostly. It had been a hardware store for 100 years, but hadn't been used for a few years. It's in Tornado Alley, so it had been hit by storms and brick blown off, and they just passed it with whatever they had. Again, it's very poor. And I said, well, the first thing we should do is tear this down. Let's tear it down and start over. It'd be cheaper. And the head of the library board is he's like, no, there's a lot of sentimentality about this building here. This is a socioeconomic hub of our city for many years. And the mayor piped up and said, yeah, when I was a kid, I used to eat barbecued beaver out of the bottom of that in the storefront there. And we'll eat anything in Arkansas. So what to do? And so we began to think about this building as an artifact in itself and how we could represent that in a particular way. So rather than change the form or any of the ticks and wrinkles that had accrued over time, we decided to leave it essentially as a ruin and then develop a new syntax of doors, windows, columns, storefronts, and just starting with this one detail, this little soap bubble detail that begins to inframe the brick ornament on the building, keep the glass out of the openings, and that way you could begin to turn this library inside out and have displays throughout the building out onto the street. So that was the basic strategy. And we had to do all of this for $108 a square foot. This is still the least expensive public library in the state of Arkansas. And it was just, again, a simple language, just reusing the existing openings and just steel fins, all load-bearing, to create a new storefront and just sort of reoccupy the voids of the space. Tough Town, that's the mayor on his motorcycle. He owns a tattoo parlor. His name is Wes Hope, one of the best politicians I've ever met because you have to deal with politics in small towns especially. It took 7 years for this building from conception to realization. Had to have it rebid 3 times. It was just an underfunded project, but we got it built. And the town's very sort of proud of that. So you see all the stacks on the ground floor with the reading areas. There's on the narrow part is the community room, and then next to that is the Little Debbie snack food part. And in the back is a plaza, and then the future home of their an exhibition for their antique fire truck. So all of this comes together, and then upstairs is their genealogy department and the librarian. She wanted to be alone upstairs. She doesn't like people. It's kind of strange. She likes books, though, so that's good. And it lights up at night. It's located right in the center city as a kind of beacon. This drawing begins to illustrate this sort of kit of parts that we came up with the chassis, the building, existing building as the chassis, and then the parts that are attached to that, including a 16-foot tall beacon that's located over an existing skylight. And that marks, in many ways, the center of town that acts as a city center. And then just glass with structural silicone on the north side that's hung. So we build forms, plywood forms, and sticks in reverse to allow the glass to hang and let it cure for 28 days. And we pull it away, and everything just hangs in there. And it comes like a soap bubble, just a real thin, transparent interface between the street and the reading areas. And then the ceiling is an existing tin ceiling, so the mayor got the county prisoners to take it down one by one, number them, and then they were restored and put back up. The columns had to be replaced, so we put these Mesian columns back, and then we wrapped them in books and wrapped them in glass, and then put light in the bottom, and those become the lighting for the inside. There's a the old mechanical lift becomes an exhibit, so there's exhibits all throughout. Then up top, the librarian and her sanctuary, let's say. And then this is the infill here for these light boxes that bounce north light in, and it's a way of taking the prosaic and introducing the spiritual into a place. And this is the first National Library Award winner in the state of Arkansas. It's been a few since. Was built, like I say, for $108 a square foot. It's won every award publication. But the thing that we're most proud of is that when we started the 7 years before, there were only 300 library card holders in the town of 2,500. Today, there are over 2,300 library card holders in this town of 2,500. So it goes to show you that architecture, while it may not be able to transform institutions, it can strengthen them. And it really creates an atmosphere of hope, and especially in small towns like this. So to follow up on that, we were approached by a congregation of Orthodox Christians who are worshiping in a rundown office building in Springdale, Arkansas. And they had bought some land near the interstate, 3 acres, that came with a house. And they wanted to, in many ways, have a place to worship. And they only had $100 a square foot. So they were like, well, can you build this for us up here? And we're like, yeah, if we make it out of papier-mâché or something. But, and if you see the images down here below, these are all adventures in religious architecture in my neck of the woods here. And all out of metal buildings. It's kind of interesting that most people where I'm from want to make a church out of a metal building. And what we wanted to do is really kind of rethink all of that. But what could we do for $100 a square foot? Now, to add insult to injury here, this is what we had to start with. They said, could you turn this metal shed into a sanctuary, into a church? And I was like, well, okay. $100 a square foot, we can't build the other thing. And then we'd have everything we want, our icons and our symbols and all that. And I said, well, we'll try. We again went back to origins and thought about proportions, classical Greek proportions for the Greek Orthodox. And how we might kind of pull those proportioning system forward in time and rethink how the church might look in its own time out of this simple material. So the church is still there, I mean the metal building is, but this is what became that metal building. This is the church that it became. All golden proportions, everything loaded into the facade, kind of sacred face that faces the highway, the interstate, as a type of billboard. And this was achieved by just leaving the existing building and then reskinning it, adding 10 feet to the front, the new narthex and a steeple, so we can get on an east-west axis through the sanctuary, and then a fellowship hall with operable walls that can connect the two. Very simple layout. And then using this box with metal system, again, we customized the corners. Everything is coursed out. We had to put a concrete pad there just to kind of show where the fire exit is. But very as abstract as we could make it with these off-the-shelf systems. And then we light it up at night. And a section through the narthex, so Father John's office up top. We cut through. There's a niche for St. Nicholas, their patron saint. And then the return air duct is actually a cabinet that floats, and then the top of it is filled with a steel tray and sand that's filled with candles, and then the blood of Christ that washes down through the steeple. So this is the little entry with the candles. You pick up a candle, then you make your way in to the sanctuary. And then we cut one window on the east side to create some morning light during worship service, kind of comes in and fills the space. Very simple chairs, iconostasis out of angle iron, and Father John in all his regalia. Now, one thing that was very important for them is to have a dome. And we couldn't put a dome on the existing metal building because of the superstructure, but they allowed us to put a dome on the inside. But the problem was they didn't have money for a dome, and we were really scratching our heads trying to figure out how to do it, because they couldn't build a custom dome. They didn't have the skill for that, and we couldn't get something off the rack. Anyways, the contractor came up with an idea. He said, I know a guy out in the country that for two cases of beer, we can get a satellite dish, and then we can truck the satellite dish in, and that can become the dome. So that's what we did. We were in the middle of construction, and we kind of brought it in its own natural lath, so we skim coated it with plaster, jacked it up, and there's the dome. And in the spirit of all this, fellow on the building committee was like, you know, I don't know where we can get a free bishop's throne, too. It's all out of walnut and crushed purple velvet, and I can get it for free. And I said, really, from where? And he goes, well, it's from an ad campaign at a local liquor store. I was like, oh. He goes, I just don't know what we're going to do with the embroidered CR on it. I go, what do you mean? He goes, you know, Crown Royal. I was like, oh. Father John overheard us and stepped over and he says, no, Christ the Redeemer. So, anyways, that's how we work. In Arkansas. So this little structure, 2013, won the national award. When they called us, they said, we just want to let you know that we did some research, and we discovered that this is the least expensive building ever to win a national AI award in the United States in the history of the awards program. And that was great news to us, because it allows us to leverage this notion that as architects, we should be able to have architecture happen anywhere, at any scale, and just about at any budget. And if anybody tells you different, this is an example that says otherwise. So the last, I'm going to show one more project I'm done. Okay? Or how you doing, Nina? You beating them off?
Yes, I've got them.
You got them? Yeah?
We are at the limit of our time.
Well, I have one project and I'm done. How's that? Okay, good. I'll talk fast. So the last project I want to share with you. I was the head of our school for 6 years, and in the middle of being the head, it's a strange story, but we got the commission to do the new architecture school, which is kind of weird, but it happened. We've been in this library that you see up here in this Beaux-Arts building for 40 years, but we never had landscape and interiors and architecture together. They were scattered around campus. So we got the money to renovate 65,000 square foot architecture school, but to add 35,000 square foot to it to make 100,000 square foot project. And it was a real challenge, this idea of adding old to the new. And of course, the idea of just repeating this neoclassical bar on the west side would be anathema. Why can't we as architects in our time build in our time as these architects were allowed to build in their time? And that was the challenge we put back to the university, which they gave us a little bit of free rein, which was quite good to see what we could come up with. And again, we just started looking at the existing and the proportions and scale, the regulating lines, and how we could begin to tie into that. The material palette, limestone on the left. So we went to the original quarry and developed limestone rain screen panels, very thin, that we could make quite large, that hang. It's all post-tension concrete, because we wanted a counterweight to the existing building, not steel and something light, be like a box kite, might blow away. So we wanted something really heavy, so it's all architectural concrete. We got an architectural concrete consultant that had worked with Ondo and his Pulitzer Museum in St. Louis, so we knew we could get some good concrete for very little money. And then we developed this addition, which was the same width and length as the existing neoclassical bar. But then rather than making the figures, the windows, and the building mass, the ground, as they did in the old way, we, through technologies and new thinking about space, can make the building the figure and the fenestration the ground. And so there's a real didactic moment for our students to see how to build and how to think about architecture in multiple ways. And then when they come together on the inside, there's some really wonderful things that happen. And then we light it up at night. We're no longer the building that's, you know, hermetically sealed and people wonder what goes on all hours of the night. Now they can see that, this kind of jellyfish beacon in the middle of campus. And we've created a new axis, an axis that runs all the way through the buildings that connects with the existing axes on the campus here. With a small bosque for reading and hanging out. Take the trees, 5 minutes and I'm done. We'll take the trees that had to come down with a new building and repurpose those into lumber. It becomes a tableau. We can talk about face grain, long grain, end grain. Becomes part of a social space along that main axis, along with other exhibits of student work. as well. And then just a variety of classroom spaces, the shop, the candy store, we like to call it, with all the new 3D printers and CNC machines and wood shop, all repurposed in the existing building. A new gallery, never had a gallery before, so we now can have traveling exhibitions. The first one was on Faye Jones. New studios. The old reading room is transformed into a studio with completely, as you can see, the existing transformed just through getting the systems, HVAC and lighting, to work properly and to be integrated into the articulation of the space. New lighting, new desks, new ways of occupying classrooms. And then where the old and new come together in the central space, bad acoustics, bad lighting, two-story high space where all the reviews are conducted, the main reviews. We developed a 2,500 square foot lampshade over light that creates even lighting and is perforated for acoustics where the reviews happen, and then it floats just above or has skylights that run around the perimeter. And then we cut an oculus into that because we're stacking studios on top. We're using every bit of available space that we have. And then that oculus connects us back to the sky in the middle of the space. And then this slot here, steel line, is that connection to the new addition. A lot of mock-ups, looking at the brise-soleil. We had to control western sun and do it passively. So glass fritted, brise-soleil fins, looking at the best orientation to maximize energy savings. And then that becomes the one big window for the entire western facade and really creates a wonderful balance of light and cooling. 100 degrees outside, you can touch the glass on the inside and it's cool as a cucumber. And then the joint between the old and new becomes the stairways, the exit, new exit stairs, retreats, social spaces, and then pin-up spaces, as you can see, with these doors that all slide that reveal printing and sinks and other types of things that have been decentralized throughout the building. The new auditorium, red is our color, that's our school color, so it needs to be red. And then if you can see in the section, the auditorium, the teaching auditorium, but underneath it is the student lounge. Right here, we call it the Boneless Chicken Ranch. It's where all the students hang out, relax, sleep, beanbag chairs, whatever they need. It's all wrapped in felt. And then we have a double screen system. So we push the screen out at the top so we get a space behind that, which is our own faculty lounge where we can get together and gossip about students. And then on the top, a green roof, a laboratory for our landscape architect students to study Ozark sedum roofs. Faculty offices, seminar rooms, an outdoor covered classroom overlooking the Boston Mountains. Kind of a place of refuge and prospect. And then the lineage that you see in our oldest building on campus as it begins to work its way back to the newest. So I know people are standing outside dying for us to leave, and that kills the Q&A a little bit, but we could do that back at the building if people wanted to do that. I really appreciate your time and patience, and I hope in some way what we've been able to demonstrate is that that architecture is possible anywhere, at any scale, in any budget. Thank you.